In an older video, I looked at how the Republic of China, Taiwan, started TSMC. It's been a few years since, and I recently watched that video and cringed. I think it is time to try and tell this story again. Today, we will again look at the origins of Taiwan's semiconductor makers out in its Silicon Valley of Hsinchu, a place perhaps more befitting of the name today than the original. But first, this video is brought to you by the Asianometry Patreon. Early access members get to see new videos first, and selected references for those videos. Early access really helps me a lot, and I appreciate every pledge. Thanks, and on with the show. In the 1970s, Taiwan faced new political and economic challenges. In 1971, the Republic of China lost its seat in the United Nations, replaced by its hated rival, the People's Republic of China. Soon thereafter, in September 1972, Taiwan broke official diplomatic relations with Japan, one of its critical allies. Then came the oil crisis in 1973, which struck Taiwan's economy. Growth, at the time heavily dependent on plastics and heavy industry, fell drastically. It opened the government's eyes to needed changes. Taiwan's electronics industry was then its second largest exporter, but that industry mostly consisted of electronics assembly operations, essentially low-value manual work. The first such factory was built by General Instrument in 1966, then followed by Phillips and Texas Instruments. A few local entrepreneurs entered the business too, founding companies like Orient Semiconductor and Lingsen Precision Industries. But on the whole, Taiwan did not have much in terms of semiconductor engineering knowledge. One notable exception was National Jiao Tong University, or NCTU, out in Hsinchu, which started Taiwan's first semiconductor lab in 1964. Hsinchu's NCTU was founded in 1957 with the help of alumni from the former Jiao Tong University in the city of Shanghai. That university is now Shanghai Jiao Tong University. NCTU was and is still known for recruiting Chinese-American professors from the United States to teach. It was a great way to infuse leading knowledge from abroad into young students. Unfortunately, at the time, many Taiwanese educated in electrical engineering went abroad to do their work. Taiwan at the time did not have a strong industrial base in semiconductors, so the best job an EE graduate could get was making home appliances or other components. NCTU has since merged with National Yangmin University and is now the awkwardly named National Yangmin Jiao Tong University, or NYCU. Is one of Hsinchu's two big universities, the other being National Tsinghua University. NYCU's Semiconductor Research Center is now the Nano Facility Center. At the start, Taiwan's policy goals were not semiconductors, but rather computers and consumer electronics. In 1965, the Vice Minister of the Ministry of Communications, Walter Fei, received a suggestion from a longtime RCA researcher named Pan Wenyuan to fund a series of forums. Scholars and industry leaders came to these forums from abroad to talk about technological developments to professors, students, and engineers in Taiwan. Many speakers came from companies like Bell Labs and IBM. They did not divulge trade secrets, but did share their excitement about the developing semiconductor technology industry. By 1970, it was clear that semiconductors had a big role to play in electronics of all types. In the same decade, Republic of China Premier Zhang Jingguo, son of Chiang Kai-shek and later to be president, kicked off its 10 major construction projects. After this, Zhang began thinking about the next big economic development project. He went to his advisors for suggestions. At this time, power in Taiwan was consolidated in a small number of ministers with common university ties. They regularly met in breakfast shops, talking about the great potential of advancing semiconductor technology in computers. While eating together in the little Xinxin breakfast shop, Fei and other ministers in the Ministry of Communications drew up plans to start an electronics research lab. The vision for this lab at the time was to build a consumer electronics industry using versatile and low-cost integrated circuits. These chips would be designed and manufactured in Taiwan. In 1973, the Minister of Economic Affairs, Sun Yun-shen, set up the Industrial Technology Research Institute, or ITRI. Its original intent was to consolidate three other industrial research institutes, the Chemistry Institute, the Metal Institute, and the Mining Institute. ITRI later found a mission to acquire, introduce, and transfer new technologies to Taiwan's private industry. The lab envisioned by Fei and the other members of the Ministry of Communications would eventually be placed there. On September 1, 1974, the Electronics Industrial Research Organization, or ERSO, became ITRI's fourth lab. The name emphasized that the end industrial goal was not semiconductors, but rather electronics products like computers and mini computers. In order to get an IC industry, you need to learn and acquire the technology first. But there are so many types, which one? To decide, the government founded the Technical Advisory Committee, or TAC, in 1974. The committee was staffed with Chinese nationals working for American companies like IBM or Bell Labs, led by the aforementioned Dr. Pan Wenyuan. Many had attended Princeton University. The committee selected complementary metal oxide semiconductors, or CMOS. This is a departure from most American semiconductor producers, which made bipolar junction transistors, or NMOS transistors. CMOS was then already known and sometimes used in the technologies for specific industries, but had a reputation for being tricky to work with. Several TAC members who worked at IBM were skeptical that it could be done, so TAC selecting it was risky. But TAC focused on the technology's low power consumption and potential suitability for consumer electronics products. This again was their North Star, this focus on eventually building Taiwanese consumer electronics. While ICs were important to this, it was not the end goal. Key to Taiwan's semiconductor learning efforts was a technology transfer agreement that ERSO struck with RCA for their 7 or 7.5 micron, sources vary on the exact number, CMOS technology. 1974 and 1975 were down years for the semiconductor industry. Many American semiconductor companies found themselves in difficult financial straits, so they were willing to teach what they knew for the right price. So there were plenty of bidders willing to do the transfer, but which was the right one? Some of the eager bidders, like Texas Instruments, did not offer CMOS, so they were out. RCA, on the other hand, had been a CMOS pioneer. The 7 or 7.5 micron CMOS technology that RCA would transfer over was not very advanced. The leading edge node in the US at the time was around 2 to 3 microns. But TAC and ERSO did not focus on how advanced the technology was. Rather, they focused on how complete the information was being transferred over. They wanted to know everything involved, so one of the major requests in the contract was that the vendor must also train 10 semiconductor designers. This weeded out almost all of the 7 bidders. So in the end, the government chose RCA because they were already a major investor in Taiwan with a TV factory there, had a good reputation, had the right technology, and most importantly, were willing to teach the most of what they knew. RCA originally wanted $7.5 million for the contract, but in the end accepted just $3 million after some negotiating down. In order to consider the technology transfer to be complete, ERSO would build and run a demonstration plant in Taiwan, producing a real product designed in Taiwan. Only when the yield reached a certain number would the job be considered done. In May 1976, Taiwan sent about 30 to 40 individuals to RCA's plant for 6 to 12 months. The selected people were well educated. Almost everyone had a bachelor's degree, but many had master's and PhDs. Many also had training at NCTU's semiconductor laboratory. Individuals were divided into one of three groups, each responsible for learning one part of the industrial production process. The first team learned cooperation semiconductor design at RCA headquarters. A second team would learn manufacturing, fab, and quality control at RCA sites in Findlay, Ohio, and West Palm Beach, Florida. And finally, a third team covered procurement and equipment testing. RCA staff were very good teachers. They used the big brother, little brother method. The staff would show the Taiwanese little brother what to do right on the line and then leave them alone, often during the night shifts. The RCA factory was unionized, so the Taiwanese engineers needed the union's permission to work on the line, which took a month to negotiate for. The Taiwanese saw the depth of the union's involvement. One memorable union rule was that desks can be moved, but an experiment table cannot. another required there be three people to change a light bulb, one to hold the ladder, one to change the bulb, and another to supervise. Dr. Yang Dingyuan, who prepared the team to go to RCA, told them to record everything that they possibly could, even if they thought it was trivial at the time. Every item down to the toilet paper and cleaning materials in the factory was copied down and stored for later. In 1977, Itri started building their first 3-inch wafer demonstration factory. The group supervising the construction stayed at RCA for a shorter time than the others before returning to Taiwan to oversee the build. This factory would be a complete copy of the original RCA fab, right down to purchasing the same equipment from suppliers, for instance an Applicon CAD system for integrated circuit design. RCA took any deviations from the contract very seriously. When the Taiwanese wanted to swap out RCA's ion implanter for a newer one, RCA resisted, saying that any deviation would not be their responsibility. There were a few things that RCA did not have, most notably the ability to produce photomasks, the templates containing the chip designs. Erso had to find an alternative source of masks for their first product, a chip for a high-altitude military propaganda balloon. They found an overseas Chinese who sourced it for them. Erso leaned heavily on consultants to plug in the gaps in their knowledge. The R.J. Siegel Company was hired to design the clean room. A former RCA supervisor was brought on for additional color. The demo fab's final cost was about $9 million. One of the things the Erso team focused on learning from RCA was yield improvement. This means maintaining very strong control over gas, water, pressure, and dust. Equipment required the operator's judgment, so performance often depended on the specific operator. RCA's contract guaranteed a yield of 17%. The demo fab's yield started off at 70% and then reached 81% by December, surpassing the original RCA factory's performance. Semiconductor pioneer Robert Zhao later attributed this to newer equipment like the aforementioned ion implanter and better workers. Many were frankly overqualified for what they were doing in the factory and went on to great things in Taiwan's semiconductor industry. And Taiwan itself was already an industrial manufacturing powerhouse. Per the U.S. Embassy in 1975, 17% of the world's TV sets were made in Taiwan. Its shipyards, auto plants, and electronics factories were world-class. This helped with the move into semiconductors. Minister Sun Yuan-shen later said that the RCA project had been Taiwan's only successful comprehensive learning project. This is because the government was not satisfied with a simple in-and-out turnkey solution. It wanted the transfer to be deep, comprehensive, and to allow for advancement. The demo fab's success led to a pie chart being drawn up, showing that its 80% yields correlated to a net profit rate of over 21%, then a very high number for a Taiwanese manufacturer. The Ministry of Economic Affairs saw this pie chart and decided that it needed to be a commercial operation. Itri's intent had always been to transfer what it acquired to private industry. So much of Taiwan's economy was state-owned at the time, and they didn't want to add to it. The big question was how to do it. Transfer it to an existing company? Start a new company? No existing private company wanted to run the fab. So in late 1979, Itri set up a preparatory office for a new company, United Microelectronics, UMC. UMC would receive a second factory that Itri built, running an upgraded 3-micron process on larger 6-inch wafers. Itri also invested millions to introduce computer simulation programs for IC designs. They twisted various Taiwanese companies to invest a small amount into UMC, giving them all a small stake in the project. Itri even selected the products that UMC would sell. They transferred chip design IP for 10 products, including those for telephones, toys, timers, calculators, and watches. One chip played a happy birthday melody for greeting cards. These were items that Taiwan's electronic industry specialized in. Founded in 1980, UMC officially began operations in 1982. After some initial struggle, UMC grew to be a profitable, growing business, producing chips like the telephone dialers exported to the U.S. market after AT&T's breakup. Ultimately, the fact that UMC survived and succeeded mattered more for the Taiwanese semiconductor industry than how it was founded. After two previous high-profile failures, Fine Products Microelectronics and Taiwan Micro Devices Corporation, UMC proved that Taiwan can compete in ICs and pave the way for bigger things down the line. UMC had been one of the first occupants of the Hsinchu Science Park, Taiwan's first industrial science park. America's Silicon Valley began with a single company, Shockley Semiconductor Laboratory in Palo Alto, situated next to two universities. Taiwan's Silicon Valley emulated this model. Has Minister Without Portfolio Dr. K.T. Lee implemented the idea after successfully doing a first economic export zone down in Kaohsiung in Taichung? They chose Hsinchu to host the park because the region also had two major universities. NCTU had been very small at the time. The government then expected to soon retake the mainland and restore Jiao Tong University. Ergo, this campus wasn't given much compared to Hsinchu's other major university, National Tsinghua University. When it became clear that retaking the mainland was not happening anytime soon, NCTU explored relocation. One particular plot in Kaohsiung attracted them. Worried, the Hsinchu local council appealed to Premier Zhang Jingguo himself. Zhang intervened by directing the military to transfer 2,000 hectares of land for NCTU's new campus, allowing Hsinchu to keep its second university. Later, when touring the area, Zhang's only comment was not to cut down the trees in order to keep it more park-like. The park opened in December 1980 and struggled to find occupants. This is where Itri and Urso contributed by acquiring new technologies, either by importing from abroad or via partnership with foreign companies, a la IMEC, and spinning them off as startups. Since its founding, Itri has spun off over 162 companies. UMC and TSMC are the most famous, of course, but others include Vanguard International, Phison Electronics, and Syntec, one of the first design houses. As the park filled up, overseas Chinese returned home with ideas, founding design houses. Design houses were basically designers with ideas for products, but no fab, fabless companies before the term came about. But these design houses soon found no foundry capacity available to produce their designs. Left with no choice, they contracted with Japanese semiconductor makers. This caught the attention of Itri's then chairman, some guy named Morris Zhang. And so, Zhang proposed an idea he had in mind for a company that would produce anyone's chip designs. This became TSMC. Let a somersault into the end. Taiwan did not set out with the intention to build a semiconductor industry and leave it at that. They wanted to build a complete IT industry, computers, tools, and instruments. ICs would be at that industry's heart, but they were the means to the goal, not the goal itself. And interestingly, I think that is a major reason why it did so well. To build expertise, the Taiwanese closely studied and emulated the American Silicon Valley model, and also extensively tapped the networks of Chinese Americans who had previously gone abroad to the US and who then brought their learnings back home. Two things before we end. First, this story neglects many of the non-semiconductor businesses expanding at the time in Hsinchu. This includes computer companies like Acer and its many spin-offs including BenQ, Asus, and Wistron. I will cover Taiwan's computer industry success in a future video. And finally, I'm struck by how young some of the head people running the RCA and Itri projects were at the time. Hu Dinghua led the whole technology transfer project at RCA, and he was only 33 years old at the time. And Dr. Yang Dingyuan, who selected and trained the team who would go to RCA, he just turned 28 years old in 1976. None of these people were doing it for the money. They could earn far more elsewhere. They did it because they believed that there was a great opportunity in front of them. They truly were pioneers, blazing a new journey for their nation. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.